First thing we'll do is around the room, introduce everybody.
Do you mind if some of us move up, because we can't hear you?
Please. So we'll introduce everybody.
Hi, I'm Senator Geffert. I have replaced John Unger, who was appointed. And I represent the 16th Senatorial District, which is all of Jefferson County and half of Berkeley.
Good afternoon, Jason Barrett, 61st District in Memphis.
Good afternoon, Chuck Hurst, 62nd District, Northern Park, Berkeley County.
Dan Delia, Berkeley County Council.
Eddie Gopinar, Berkeley County Council.
Doug Gopinar, Berkeley County Council President.
Jim Whitaker, Berkeley County Council Vice President.
Jim Barnhart, Berkeley County Council.
Charles Trump, State Senate 15th District.
John Hardy, the 63rd District.
Don Porsche, I'm soon to be in the 91st District.
All right, I'm Summer Barrett. I represent the county.
And Darrell Coles, I'm a legislative representative, region representative for Government Justice.
Yes, I'm Jonathan Adler, the executive director for the West Virginia Association of County Officials.
Anthony Delegatti, legal director of Berkeley County.
Matt Umstead with the Berkeley County Council.
Good, Patty Ann Martin.
Hey, Patty Show, Thomas, the minister of the Berkeley County Council.
Got one beside you, too.
Tracy McCormick, the chairman, coordinator for Berkeley County Council.
Alan Davis, county administrator.
Denise Allen, CCAWB.
Jennifer Piercy with CCAWB.
If you all want to pull your chairs in closer, please do. This room is a big room to fill. We want everybody to understand what's going on and be part of the conversation. We'll make sure Jonathan and Jennifer, you all, we'll talk about your all's priorities, which I think a lot of your all's priorities, I think Jennifer is exactly our priorities. Ask to make sure that you all know where we are and things of that nature. Jonathan, I'm sure your priorities are a little different because you represent all of the elections. Yeah, Jennifer, if you all want to move on up here, y'all can.
Sure.
First of all, I just want to give each and every one of y'all a little bit of background on Berkeley County because a lot of people at the state, we hear it all the time. Governor even said at one time he came up and had a very good week with us because of their leadership is what are you all doing in Berkeley County with all the money, right? And so we like to work off of spreadsheets and we wanted to do one day I asked Alan and Gary how poor are we? And back 3 years ago we were the 10th poorest county in the state of West Virginia per capita. I think the last time I checked, I think we're 21st, and that was just last year. So we always like to say we do more with less, right? That's our goal, just like yours. But we have to do a better job, and the bad thing about that is it gives the perception that we're quite low. The other thing that we're dealing with in Berkeley County that is no secret is our growth. Growth comes, as you know, it comes with a huge amount of expenses, and then we even collect our taxes in the following year for the growth that we see. To give you some idea, for the third year, actually the last 2 years, we had over 1,300 new addresses per year. And you turn around and do the math, that's 2.5 people according to the census every year for every household. This year, currently today, we're at 1,434 new addresses. We still have 2.5 weeks to go, 3 weeks to go. So we'll probably peak out about 1,500. That's 1,500 would be 3. That's about 3,800 new people in Berkeley County this year alone. So over the last 3 years, we've got to think we gave out about 5,000 new addresses, which equates to 12,500 new people in Berkeley County. 2010, our census report was 104,000. 2020 was 122. When we've done a redistricting, we allotted for 14,000 new people plus in the next 3 years in Berkeley County. So we just got done, Gary and his team just got done doing redistricting. We're going to go from 66 precincts to 80 precincts. And some of his staff wanted to go to 100. So that gives you a little bit of background. And it's no secret that the word was out, I think last year, that before 2020, it was actually 2030, I think it was out, but it's probably going to be 2025, that Berkeley County may be the heaviest populated county in the state of West Virginia.
That was the projections given to us by John Deskins with WBU.
And was it 2025 or 2030?
2025.
So when we ask for things, it's not that we try to tell you that we need more money. It's just that we're growing that fast. And one of the biggest things that I actually talked to Senator Trump about one day when we crossed paths was Berkeley County is getting to the point now where we need water, we need sewer, we need roads, and almost to the point, I believe, that we're going to start seeing the need for bridges over bridges. Exit 12 is a very, very tough spot. For you all that live in Martinburg on the west side, you'll notice that Route 9 between Martinburg at least Route 7 Back Creek Valley, you don't want to be in that congestion between 4:30, 5:30, somewhere around there, because you're going to back up all the way to the tractor supply in Martinsville. And then you'll notice that the traffic coming across Dry Run is probably equivalent to the traffic that used to be on Route 9 25 years ago. Charlie, you talked about that. You've got slowdown, right? You get stuck in every day. And it's just the opposite in the morning. So just want to make sure that see the need. Daryl, you probably travel up there a little bit too. There's a lot of things we'll talk about that. Councilperson Logan and I want to make sure that one of the priorities is about trying to bring money back to Berkeley County to help. Our biggest complaint right now is traffic congestion and broadband. No secret. So, I guess we'll get in, and it's just open discussion, so anytime anybody wants to speak out, just go ahead and speak out, and we'll just keep it orderly, and we'll go from there. The same National Council will be jumping in anytime they need to. But the one thing that we were talking about was the legal notice last year. Just wanted to kind of where we are on that, and I know that I think if I'm not mistaken, the state said that they were going to do something with that and do a sample and see how it went and then see whether the counties could do it. Is that right, Ken? So how's that study going? And because last year we spent over $250,000 in publications.
And my understanding last year where we left that was we were going to do a study on that and we were going to try to come up with a plan to try to slowly implement that. We didn't want to blindside, a lot of these publications with a huge hit at once. We were trying to think of a way that we could work with them and try to work with, we could slowly work that in. Still do some of the public notices, but maybe not everything that a legal notice, and just start taking bits and pieces of it. Be really pragmatic about it.
I think the state was going to do some of theirs to try to see how it went, how that study's going on.
So the portion of the bill that passed had the final version of the bill made it so the website would be created and state agencies would begin putting their legal notices on the website, just to at least get the website started, get some activity on it. But they still also are required to continue publishing their so it's only been a few months.
So we only have 6 months of data to collect.
Yeah.
We can collect that data, and that would be the first small bite of the apple. And then if we see that we can grow that, which I think that's probably the direction we should go to, is try to grow that. Maybe this year we can have to take another small bite.
So I understand your thought process and the idea of doing it the way you're doing, but I remember correctly, the last couple of years, didn't we double in what we were paying? What was it?
Yeah, our publications, the number of class one and class two publications that we're required to do by law have pretty much remained the same, but the advertising rates have almost doubled. To the point where we, for example, we don't even, when we have a vacancy, an employment vacancy, we don't even do an ad in the local newspaper because it's cost prohibitive. So the only advertising costs that we incur are the ones that are required by law for class one, class two legal ads.
And my point is, I understand you trying to go easy on it, but it's coming the other way for us. We start trickling it down over a period of time. Are we saving anything out of the county? You know, it's still increasing at a faster rate.
I understand what you're saying. Your costs are rising faster than they're increasing.
What's the number of subscribers? It's continually and they go down.
We know that the circulation rates for print are very low.
Okay, so we're not paying technical.
And that's probably why the cost of the advertising is going up.
I don't think any of us want to take this slow approach that we're going to end up having to do.
Right.
It's a matter of what does it take to get 51 votes in the House and what does it take to get 18 votes in the Senate? And the reality of it is that there are legislators scared of the local newspaper. And that's the political reality that we're facing. And it certainly doesn't matter to me, but I completely agree with, it's a waste of money. I think that we have an obligation to notify folks through a legal notice, but in the 21st century, in 2021, doing that in the newspaper is not the most effective way to do it anymore. So we'll continue to do that. Alan, did you say that the rate is going up? And how is that rate determined? It's my understanding that newspapers had to charge a very low rate. Is that rate not set somewhere? I don't know if anybody else knows the question. Do you know?
Matt?
I think that's only in campaign.
Are set. There is a. How is it set?
Sure. But there is some rate set by someone other than the newspaper that they can charge, correct?
Yes, I believe so.
Can we find out what that rate is and who determines what that rate is? And maybe that's part of in the short term, as we move forward with trying to implement this in a slower process than we want, but maybe we can come at it a different angle and maybe start to reduce some of these rates. And that would save you all some money before we get to the point where we can fully implement having this online.
Yeah, I mean, print is so old at this point. The thing that replaced print was Facebook advertising, and it's already phased out. People that are doing social media advertising are limiting what they're putting on Facebook and going on to the next social media platform.
Our publication costs just for delinquent property taxes that we have to do twice a year is almost $100,000 a year.
And I agree with Jason, taking the slow approach is not something that we want to do. It's just trying to get everyone on board because there are some representatives that live in areas where their print is still pretty powerful and they're just afraid of what's going to be done about it.
I have a question about, it was my understanding that each individual housing project that's built comes to the Planning Commission separately, so that they're voting on each project separately, not at the 25 projects that are going to be done in the next 6 months, let's say.
Sure, they're advertising
I'm not talking about the advertising, I'm talking about the Planning Commission itself, that it looks at one development at a time, and that doesn't look so bad, but if you look at, we're getting 25 of these new developments in, that does affect water, roads, all that, all our infrastructure.
We don't have them all. That's a whole different issue. We're talking about the advertising, all
But I also think that you're also talking about growth, aren't you?
Well, that was my introduction.
Right, that was your introduction, so that's why I have that question about how that process is effective by looking only at individual projects individually, as opposed to saying we're getting 20 of these new projects in the next 6 months.
Awesome. All those projects are looked at and approved by the Water and Sewer District before going to the planning commission.
Okay.
All right, they're all approved by the state DOH for highway entrance permits in the district traffic. They're the ones that have authority over traffic models. So they are looked at, grouped together as one, as they come in, right? We don't, in order for your project to go forward, you gotta have a letter from the Water and the Sewer Districts to even go into the process of preliminary plat approval and the planning commission. Right? So.
And we are doing, and we do have long-term planning. Jim Barnhart's not here to talk about the water. We do have long-term planning for the Water Department right now that we're trying to implement. That's that's a 15 to 20 year plan to be able to sustain growth that at the rate that we're going right now.
Are we also bringing the school board into that?
Yes.
Delegate Barrett, advertising rates are actually set by West Virginia Code 59-3-3, and it's on a sliding scale based on circulation. And the sliding scale starts at 4 cents per word and goes up to as high as 11 cents per word based on circulation.
So the higher the circulation, the higher the rate?
The higher the rate.
Right. So I don't know how the rate would be going up if the circulation
was. Should be the other way around.
Yeah, well, it says it starts out at 4 cents per word.
Okay.
If the circulation is less than 1,000, and then it goes up to 11 cents per word if the circulation is above 30,000 or more.
I just wonder if maybe there's some necessary audit to make sure you're getting charged the right amount.
Don't know. So it is a sliding rate set by code.
I thought it was set something. Thank you.
If I recall correctly, I believe you also heard arguments that some of these subscriptions or newspapers were also using online stuff as far as subscriptions to their things go, which makes it look like the print is a much more important ordeal.
Right. Yeah. Online subscriptions are better, bigger now than paper.
Yeah.
I mean, our paper actually closed down our facility there in Berkeley County, and all their print is being done over in Frederick. So that's how much that tells us sort of in itself.
Doesn't it have to be done for so many days in a row, though?
Well, it depends. For example, once the council passes the levy rate, we have to do a class two legal, which is two separate publications. It has to be done in separate weeks, at least 7 days apart. So it depends on, the code has different requirements for different publications, either class one or class two. If it's a class one, it just means it has to be advertised once. If it's class two, then we have to advertise it twice.
Yeah, so maybe that would be an easy bite to take out, to where you would advertise one on one of those publications on print and the other one online. You know, that may be an easy one to get a little bit down the road.
Yeah, some of the legislators have expressed a willingness for a compromise similar to what you're saying, to where the first time you publish it, it would be the full advertisement, and then like on the second day, it would just be the website. So you're paying for a lot less, you know, a lot fewer words. You would just pay to say, here's where you can find the full advertisement. Some legislators have said that they would support a compromise like that.
We're constantly trying to think of ways that we can save money and still protect the citizens of Berkeley County. This is one of them, so thank you for that. I'd like for you to continue to move forward on that as much as possible. The next one is regional jail, at least the pro diem, or I think there's some talk about trying to 96 people in home confinement. We have about 300 people in day report center. We have a huge amount of people in community service work, and then we have the recovery services. But at the same time, you know, $2 million our budget, which is a big chunk, which could be up to $5 million. And the biggest thing is for the smaller counties in the state of West Virginia, I know they're really suffering, and they can't afford to try to find a diversion program like we have. So I know there's been talk about maybe taking that over, I think you said on that Senator Trump, about maybe the state taking over, trying to check in the per diem. Can you bring us up to date where that might be and what the forecast or outlook might look like?
Yeah, I can tell you what I know, Doug. The, of course, we have in here, we did pass the bill for 1 year freeze on, because the per diem was scheduled to go up. It had been frozen at that $48 before. In my conversations with the president, let me back up and say, as you guys all know, the legislature passed a resolution that will be on the ballot this November, which will allow the citizens of the state to vote on the question of whether or not to amend the Constitution to authorize the legislature to exempt, lower, reduce, or eliminate the ad valorem tax on tangible personal property. So that's machinery, equipment, inventory, motor vehicles, all that stuff that people get property tax bill from the sheriff. It'll be on the ballot this November. Right now, the Constitution prohibits the legislature from lowering. And I've been at a bunch of meetings with Jonathan and Municipal League and Boards of Education, and everybody's a little nervous. We understand that, because that money doesn't go to the state by and large. A very small piece of it does, but very small. The biggest piece of it goes to county boards of education, and then county commissions or councils after that, and then within the municipalities, there's a municipal levy. And so we understand that everyone's nervous what that might mean. In my conversations with Craig, and I think we all feel the same way, we are not going to let the rug be pulled out from under county commissions or boards of education or municipal levy or municipalities if the voters approve that. And so I think what you will see this year, I'm hoping you're going to see this year, is the legislature put together a plan of what we would do, how we would implement it going forward if the voters approve it in November. And so back around to your fundamental question, I think part of that is going to be, at least it's under consideration now, I've talked to Craig about it, part of that is having the state take over the regional jail expense. And hence, you know, we want to hold the counties and municipalities and boards of education harmless. Now, Berkeley County is one of those counties where that's it's probably harder here than it is in, you know, all but maybe probably 40 of the other counties, because the you know, a lot of the counties have seen declines in their personal property tax revenue. And so, you know, it's easier to do for those counties. But as you know, the state's budget right now is in pretty good shape. Way different from what we were looking at 4 years ago when we were flat broke. And I think what you can look for this session is a serious effort made anyway, trying to do something that makes sense for that, holds counties and boards of ed and municipalities harmless in state dollars, that may include as part of that taking over the regional jail expense and responsibility.
Would that have a building calculation to increase in population, like we're saying? And plus keep in mind, Senator, that we have
all these collars in place too. So those are starting to get there. Okay, the Mason started going there. So last year, right?
2 years ago.
2 years ago, $1 million in the first payment. And so all the Masons is coming in, as you know, in order for us, because of personal property tax and business tax and stuff like that, we haven't been able to pay the business taxes.
Right. And it, you know, that's it's a great point. That needs to be part of the mix if we are going to try to craft something. We definitely have to think about that. You know, the idea behind doing it as a constitutional amendment and letting it happen is so that smaller businesses can get the same kind of benefit, economic benefit, that is negotiated for big businesses with those pilot programs.
Small businesses.
Yep, and they provide a lot of tax revenue, and you know we make efforts to make the state attractive to big businesses by having pilot programs or that sort of thing to try to make us more attractive. And at some level, it seems you know it's good to do. We want to grow the business. But at some level, it seems unfair sometimes to the smaller businesses that have been here and are paying those taxes and not getting the benefit of those kinds of arrangements. So all I can tell you is I think all of us understand how important those dollars are to county commissions, school boards, and municipalities. You know, I think there's a commitment. I think it's bipartisan. I think it's bicameral. I think both houses, you know, feel the same way. We don't want to see any bit of the rug pulled out from under, you know, the local governments that provide those important services for the citizens.
The problem is the phase out of personal property tax. It sounds like it's going to be a multi-year plan. The current temporary freeze on per diem rate for the regional jail bill expires on June 30th. And if it goes from $48.25 per inmate per day to $54.13 per inmate per day, that's an increase of about a little bit more than 12%. That's going to be between $300,000 and $400,000 for us.
Right. Understood.
And you know, that is, if nothing else, if until the whole, you know, until the personal property tax decision is made, if this per diem freeze could be extended for another year or two, Jennifer, I know you've talked to some of the other counties.
We made a request to the interim committee that they consider extending the freeze through July 2023, so there's time to.
Well, and that seems reasonable. I don't know the exact number. It's in my memory that the whole nut on that tangible personal property tax is $550 million. So, Alan, you may be right. It may be more than the legislature could do or would be willing to do in a single year. That's a big number. It may be a multi-year phase-in. And if that's the case, you know, and this is all dependent upon the voters' approval. So we can't presume that we'll know the answer in November. But if it seems likely to me that phasing something like that in makes the most sense, and I hear you loud and clear on that, I think you're right. We need to maybe hold that freeze. So
if you could just freeze it at least for another year until you see what happens with personal property tax referendum. It would give us a little bit of, you know, a little bit of relief anyway.
That seems a reasonable request.
The other thing we're going to just to keep you abreast of what we're going, probably the third thing that we're going is when we enter into pilots and they're wanting to pay the taxes, which is drastically reduced from what they would owe us,
got done one that part of the, what we asked for is, and it's cooperation with the school board, they've agreed to this in public session, that we are asking for a quality of life payment. And the quality of life payment actually goes towards improving our, a lot of our things, walking trails, and Matt will talk about, you know, rails and trails and rails to trails and all that stuff. We're talking about parks, we got three parks we're trying to work on. One of those, between the three that is in my mind right now, it's about $1.3 million. So, you know, we're able to improve, we're trying to improve the quality of life, because what we're finding now is as businesses come into Berkeley County, a lot of their upper employees don't locate in Berkeley County. They live in Frederick County, or they live in Jefferson County, or they, you know, and one of the things is, they say that quality of life is there. So Dan brought it to our attention one time, hey, we gotta focus on quality of life, right? And so that's what we're doing. Just let you, we have a park going down in South Berkeley. Eddie and Dan's been working on, it's 25 acres plus or minus. Come to find out, it used to be a little park. Back in the 20s, I guess. We have the family, the Henry family working on a park, a 10-acre park that the school board owns, the 10 acres. They're going to lease it to them for $1 a year or whatever. And that's being worked on as a local community project. And then we're talking to the feds and everybody else, so it's Fortune's Paradise. We've been fortunate enough, the two brothers, local business owners, previous local business owners, are probably still in some type of businesses here in Berkeley County, that actually fronted just the property beside Poorhouse Farm at zero cost to the county other than reimbursement for the cost of your interest. So that's the kind of partnerships we developed, and we're trying to move that forward. So even now, that even goes a factor into this pilot program. And one of the deals we broke was with a solar company coming in, that they were going to put solar panels on the schools, and we got them to put, we negotiated that they were going to put 3 times more solar panels on the school than what they first offered. So we're doing broker the deal with the school board to benefit from that. So those are the things we're trying to do, that, and people are still knowing that Berkeley County is the place to locate.
Well, to get back to the jail issue, conversations that I've had with people about maybe the state eventually taking over the regional jails, is there need to be some criteria in place with the counties? And luckily, I think we meet all those criteria. I think if the state is going to take over those jail bills, then the counties are going to need to have a drug court, they're going to need to have a day report center, they're going to have these options in place to be able to keep the jail costs down, as the counties try to keep it down for themselves, as also try to keep it down for the taxpayers of the state. So I think before we can say the state's going to take over these regional jails, the counties that use those regional jails must have A, B, C, and D in place to try to control those costs for the state as the counties try to control them for themselves. So I think that's one place where we're going to be here. But a lot of other counties don't have this.
And John, I think we're probably one of the few counties in the state where our regional jail, our annual regional jail bill is actually going down. Since 2016, as Doug has said, but that's because we started recovery resources in January of 16. We started the day report center in August of 16. Since then, we've added adult drug court, we've added juvenile drug court, which are all real active. We've taken over home confinement. We beefed up, saw the two vehicles sitting out there when you came in. That's part of our community service program, our roadside litter. That's all under the umbrella of the council, and we've tied them all together. So participation levels are at all time high. So, you know, the council's goal all along is not only to keep people out of jail, but keep people working, keep families together, and things like that, keep people in the tax rolls and out of jail. So, and it's been effective. So, you know, if the legislation wants to use an example of how it works, just tell them to look at us. We can, I mean, numbers don't lie.
Well, I think it's important to note that you all have done that with increased population. And so if a county like Berkeley can reduce the regional jail costs by the things you just outlined with an increase in population, there's no reason in the world why the other counties that are decreasing population can't see an even more drastic decline in the regional jail bill if they take the steps that you all have here.
Our budget this year is $39 million and change, as adopted by the council. About $22 million of revenue, projected revenue, is real estate, almost 22 is projected, is real estate and personal property tax, which is the lion's share of our revenue stream. So we're affected, not, you know, we're going to talk a little bit about the rollback, so that certainly affects us. But the personal property taxes are around six, between $6 and $7 million. Well, that's if we lose that, that's a big hit.
John?
Earlier this week, on Monday, I asked the county assessors around the state, all 55, about trying to compile as best we can by how HJR3 was written, trying to figure out what losses may be for each county. It's not an easy thing to try to configure because it's kind of broad. We're trying to make our best effort. We did have a phone call meeting yesterday morning. Some counties have done that. I'm sure Larry has a copy of the spreadsheet that was sent out, and we shared one from Kanawha County with him as well, everybody. But we're trying to make that effort, trying to get it done before the end of the month, certainly before the session begins, just trying to have some kind of figures that we can show legislators about what we're looking at. And I very much appreciate Senator Trump's comments. He's right about the fear, no doubt about it. Everybody's concerned, and our thing was, you know, a few years ago when it started, I want to say 2017, maybe 2016, we'd had a lot of meetings, conversations about how to get there, how to help manufacture inventory. And at that time, there was going to be a backfill that was going to be in the Constitution that we were going to support. Had several meetings, and unfortunately, I think 2019, I guess, it kind of changed where a new bill was introduced, a couple different resolutions, where that constitutional guarantee to backfill was removed, but it's kind of taken the form now of what HJR3 passed this past year. And so I am heartened by what the senator says, and you're right about, you know, we want to see have the discussions and see what the plan is going forward. Certainly jails is a big issue that, you know, it's a part of our agenda, but there is some worry, and we just want to make sure, and we had some discussions about, you know, having our input as to what we know at the county level needs to happen to make these things work, and so that's kind of where we've been, certainly this week with the assessors, working on that.
I think probably everybody does. It's one thing to say, trust us and have everybody take that leap of faith. I think it's too much to ask, and so does Craig. I think what we need to do, is what the legislature needs to do, is enact a plan that answers all the questions. Here's what happens if the voters approve this, and put it in law that becomes effective upon amendment to the Constitution so people can see it. And that way we're being transparent. Questions like Alan's, you know, are you doing it? Are you going to phase it in over 2 years or 3 years, or what are you doing? And show us the money. Show us how you're, you know, what's the statute going to require the legislature to do each year when it makes its budget to replace money for the counties, for school boards, or to take over expenditures like regional jails that are currently, you know, in the laps of the counties. So we're in accord on that. We don't want to just ask you to trust us blindly. We think it's our responsibility to lay it out there in a statute, and people can decide this is good or it's not good. And they'll know then, when they go to vote in November, whether they're voting on something that's going to launch a good plan or a plan that's not good, and vote yes or no based on that.
Well, we've been involved in countless development projects for potential businesses to come here, and one of the things that and Doug has mentioned this several times that is mentioned to us as well, you know, we can go to Maryland or we can go to Pennsylvania because they don't have personal property tax. And our response is, yeah, but they tax you at 100% of the appraised value, whereas under West Virginia code, they're taxed at 60% of their appraised value.
You mean like real estate?
Real estate.
Real estate.
So when we would, so I mean, that's something else that affects us.
Their job is to try to figure out why West Virginia and Berkeley County is so expensive to come to. Our job is to let them know how cheap it is and why are we here. You know, doing business more here than in other counties and states. So, you know, we're very cautious about making sure that we have ourselves situated in there too. And different classification of real estate taxes and stuff for the state. That's what we're talking about. Class 2, Class 3, Class 4. That's another issue.
And that's also, I mean, as you know, that's in the Constitution. It's in Article 10, Section 1, since 1932, when the voters ratified that resolution, that real estate taxes on residences are half the taxes on the other real property.
Anybody else have anything to add to that conversation? Next one is, and Eddie, this is more something that you would want to talk about. It's a great idea. But the distribution of the federal infrastructure funds. How do we make sure that we're able to, like we won't ask, we've had some meetings with Senator Blair and Delegate Blair on trying to bring some of that infrastructure money back to Berkeley County. I know John. Talk a little bit about when that could be our water, what we do, the plan that they have to do everything with $76 million. The water district has said that they would put some skin in the game. I'm talking to the federal government, I'm talking to the state, I'm talking to Mr. Carmichael, I'm talking to chief of staff and the governor. Dan, you know a little bit more about the other people involved, but you know, Berkeley County now has to, the water plant down in South Berkeley County is the oldest plant in the state of West Virginia. So they've been doing some work on some wells on the west side up by Eddie. They want to upgrade the plant up there. We got main line distributions. Industrial zone around Taper Station. P&G is using over a million gallons a day now, and they're still growing. They just bought another 92 acres. We have development that's interesting locating on the west side of 81 at Taper Station, but they got a new promise they'll have water soon in the next 2 years. Is that right?
2 years.
Well, are we on gas?
And gas is a huge problem.
It was a great capacity.
Yeah.
It was a gas on capacity.
But that's a huge obstacle. And there's ways to overcome that obstacle. The water, there's no ways to overcome it if we don't. I mean, it's not, we can't just put in a well for a factory and be able to do it. You know? So we have aging infrastructure, undersized infrastructure. Our county infrastructure for water was not designed to do what we're doing. And so we have to get this industrial water line, and if we don't, it's going to take us to do it for ourselves several years, you know, probably
so,
7 years.
I've had some pretty in-depth conversations with Senator Blair about my approach and his approach and my approach were very close. So I think on the infrastructure side of it, the legislature is going to look at, this is probably going to be some of this is going to be an executive decision. Also, the governor is going to have to sign off on some of this, is using the IJPC, the Infrastructure and Job Development Council, which is acts as a clearinghouse for water and sewer projects across the state. That agency receives about $50 million a year from the legislature, and then about another $200 million a year from development authorities, federal grants, it's kind of all these monies come from all these different places, and then the IJDC puts together the financing of the project. So me and Senator Blair talked about trying to maybe super fund the IJDC, you know, maybe putting an additional $150 million $200 million into that to have lots of more money to work off of for these projects coming in, because we know these projects are time consuming. I mean, sometimes it takes a year to design them. They have to go out to bid, and you know, it just takes a while to get these things together. So I've talked with Eddie quite a bit about that. I think if we're going to do these projects are going to have to go through the IJDC, and they will be able to help come up with the funding. So what we can do is the county can have some skin in the game, the state can have some skin in the game, we can look for some federal grants, we can get some development authority money, and everybody puts a little bit in. And what that does, you know, what we talked about was if we could have some type of matching funds or something, it lets the county's infrastructure money go a lot further by putting the state money in and going after the federal funds too. So I think that as soon as we identify a project and we get a project, you know, start from the design phase of it, that we need to get in front of the IJDC and use them for what they're designed to do. Because we know that there's a lot of the state that is underserved in water. They just don't have water. I mean, you can't, southern part of the state, you can't just drill a well. I mean, the water's terrible. So a lot of that money is going to go south. It's going to go to these underserved communities. But we have to make sure that we're also sending it to the communities that are growing, that are paying the state's bills. So,
I mean, and it boils down to if we have to wait, we have to wait here in Berkeley County to do it on our own,
right,
which we will eventually. We're going to, we don't have a choice but to slow the growth of industry down, what we're doing. We're out of water in the center and the southern part of the county right now. And, you know, we can't handle, you know, a little bit of residential growth. Obviously, we can continue to do that, but we can't handle the growth like we've been doing.
Well, I can, you know, being on the infrastructure committee, the last thing that we want to do is to, you know, stymie a tax base, you know, coming out of the Eastern Panhandle. So, I mean, this is a perfect opportunity to use this infrastructure money that the state has received from the federal government and work these projects through these state agencies. But I think that's going to be the only way that the county is going to get the money is you're going to have to work with the state and kind of use their agency as the clearinghouse to do it. It'd be nice if they would say, listen, you have a $20 million project, we're going to swipe you a check for $20 million. We know you do good work, we know you're good stewards of the county, go do your project. It's not going to work that way. It's going to have to, it's going to be, the state's going to be involved, and that's just probably how it's going to work.
But we have, I mean, within 12 months from now, all of this will be designed.
That's good.
We have large parts of it that are already designed, but the South End plant, the design on it,
and then you will take your engineer design to the IJDC, and then there's some different agencies that check off on that, on your design, to make sure your design is sound, and then the process starts.
The biggest thing is we get the funding, the better we are, because as you know, this attraction, that's the biggest thing. I want to plant on the north end, which came through now double the capacity that they got to increase the footprint system. The building class.
Right.
But they got to increase. I know I was on the phone with Jim from the state economic development, he talked to me about two projects that was told that they couldn't serve the park right now. And
well, the thing is, we have to get moving with these projects because we have 3 years to identify, design, get them out to bid, and then we've got until 2026 to get them completed.
Yeah.
So the money's got to be spent in 2026. And I know that sounds like a long time, but we all know these water and sewer projects, they drag out 2-3 years. No problem.
So when I met with Ann Erling, who is the deputy chief of staff for the governor on Monday, and she has the $50 million request, and it's in the list of ARPA funding, but as she noted, all that's going to have to be approved by the legislature. So I think, you know, regardless of what fund it comes out of, we're going to need to encourage the members of the legislature to approve that money, so then we can get the money. But the governor's office does have that initial request, and if there are more, you know, we need to figure that out. But they do have that first request in their list of art funding.
I would also say that if the projections that, like, Alan had spoke about earlier, that 2025, that our population will be the number one in the state, that, you know, when I look at this, Kanawha County is spread out large enough, basically very similar to Berkeley, Morgan, and Jefferson geographically. So they put 160,000 people in those three counties. It's not quite as intrusive. And that's, you know, within there, you also have five different municipalities. You know, Charleston, South Charleston, Dunbar, Nitro, St. Albans. They're all in there as well. But we're going to squeeze that amount of people into this county, 324 square miles. We have got to make room for additional highways. There's no way out. We need water. There's absolutely no question about that. But we also need infrastructure. We need our highways and roads. Not only do we need additional roads, but we need the ones that we have improved and made more safe and in turn be more efficient. So we've got to be able to bring some of those dollars back here so that folks can won't be set in traffic.
That's a very great point. Berkeley County, you make folks 100 miles, they probably have this populated county the same as we all have. Right? And we don't have written over it. We don't have the infrastructure that Kanawha County has. And I'm not calling, I'm not complaining, I just say we've got to start thinking about it. And it's, you know, we want to continue to grow. We don't have money, there's nothing in place that just stopped it. Number one, we're going to make sure the people that's here are taken care of. Number two, you know, it comes to the infrastructure that we can continue to grow. Right now, the developers already have very little land that they have to sell because they have pretty much sold out. And that's another thing we've got to be careful of. We've asked the developers already, even though they're quite wealthy right now, they're very sustainable. They've got to think about what's the next place they need to go. I can tell you right now, everybody in the state of West Virginia can tell you, you can buy this property already more than ever.
Well, and the other side of that coin is, until we solve this problem and at least know there's going to be a solution, we want to try to lock up the property,
right?
You know, we don't want to lock up a bunch of property and have this water problem take us 7 years to solve, you know? So we need a solid answer. We need a solid answer of how we're going to get this resolved. And as soon as possible, so that we can continue that march down the road and acquire more property and be able to do that. We don't want all that property being gobbled up by residential along the interstate, because then the problem that he's talking about, the infrastructure, the roads, become even a bigger problem, because now we got trucks heading away from the interstate as opposed to cars heading away, and so you have, you know, that big traffic issue that way. So it just makes sense to keep them on the interstate. But like I say, it's at some point in the near future, we need to come up with a solution of how we're going to solve this water situation that we have. Seventies, they certainly, I was down in Logan a couple weeks ago, and they mentioned that fact about coal severance saving everybody, and why can't they get gas or something like that. So that's
yeah, we're willing, Jonathan and Jennifer, to say, you know, as long as you give us something, you know, once in sales tax or whatever, this is Andy's idea, we'll give the coal and oil severance money back and give it to the counties as not going to do well on the 1 cent sales tax. That's what they said. They're not going to do well on the 1 cent sales tax by replacing our personal property tax. Because the personal property tax on all the equipment in the coal. All right, give it back to coal and oil severance.
Say again, sir?
We just approved some money, some of our CARE Act money to go into the broadband expansion for a study period.
Application for the Gig Ready project right. That's available now. Yes, sir.
We just committed $1 million to go towards that.
25% match.
Today, so.
Well, I'll be honest with you, I don't know a lot about the plans for infrastructure and broadband throughout the state on the legislative side of it, because I'm not on that committee or whatever. There seems to me that there's enough broadband when he's moving around and everyone should have high-speed connection in West Virginia. I mean, there is a lot of broadband when he's moving around. I mean, just if we get this middle mile stuff finished, so then we can get the last mile, which the providers will do. I mean, there's lots of different ways that we can work on the middle mile stuff, you know, with the energy providers, highways, et cetera. You know, there's lots of those things. To me, it just seems like there's a lot of broadband.
You got to be careful on it because back 2 years ago when I was asking the cost to do a mile of broadband, it was $40,000 a mile. Today it's $87,000. More than double. And that's what the people, when people have gone up and asked them, how much would it cost to extend my house a mile down the road? It's now $87,000.
That amount that you're talking about, money that's out there for broadband, is a good argument in itself why we should be advertising online. Because we're spending that much money on broadband, everybody's going to have it, why would we want to keep it?
Well, I think if we can utilize, you know, some of our energy producers to use them for middle mile and in our DOH projects and those type things, it cuts down on the middle mile cost, right? Those savings can be used on the last mile, which is going to go out to bid by providers.
I'm pretty sure our company already said that.
They are more than willing to work with us. We've had that conversation with First Energy and AT&T.
We've actually had the conversation with OmniTrax as well about using the rail.
Right.
And they're willing to. They're willing to get into that conversation.
Right.
One of the things that we talked about, Charlie, I think he let our center. I should say that they had to charge at the property rollback, rollback tax that we have in place, it's been in place since 1987, if I'm not mistaken.
89 or 90.
Yeah. And that's killing us. I mean, it is. I mean, we've had inflation in this county of 17% a year in the last 3 years. And yet we're only able to grow our existing tax rate by 3%, and assessor gets 2% out, so 1%. So, just imagine if our home on the real estate market went up 51%, and someone said, well, you're only going to be able to sell for 3% profit over the last 3 years. That's what's happening. So our costs have gone up, our needs are going up, but yet we can only our taxes by 3% a year. And actually, the county commission, it's 1%. So I know, Jennifer, this is one of the priorities been here since I've been here, the association, and that's at least 3 years, right?
Yes. There's quite
this is another one of the things that will be penalized for being withdrawn. One of these things, this is part of the discussion I think we've talked about before, though, is homestead exemption is $20,000. Doesn't matter whether you're in Dow County or you're in Berkeley County. And, Abby's house up here, Max Hunter's home, has been out going for about $300,000. So $20,000 here would be a 7% of the total cost of a home, but down in Wood or Dow and Logan, that may be half the cost of a home, or even. So I've always said it should be a portion of the average cost of a home in the county. Because that's the biggest thing, every time there's any increases, our aging population, that's all fixed income, is the ones that want to say, think about me, please.
Well, I'm thinking, Doug, that I may be wrong, it'll take me a minute to look it up, but I'm thinking that $20,000 number is fixed in the Article 10, Section 1 of the Constitution. It can be done, but it might require a constitutional.
So, the Constitution has $20,000?
Senator, I believe you're right. I think that's absolutely right.
You guys keep talking, I'll look it up while we're here.
That one, we would love to see some change.
Well, and that's just a prime example of the problem that we face here in Berkeley County all the time, is that the rules in legislature are set for the rest of the state, and they're not set for an area like Berkeley County, Jefferson County, that has to compete north and south of us. We're a suburb of Washington, D.C. here. I mean, there's a big difference. There's such a big difference. It's a penalty for us to have to compete with the rest of the state.
Anything else on the property rollback? That's been discussed for quite a while. So. The sales tax, we've already talked about that on the tax situation. I know that's a number one priority.
It is in the Constitution. The first $20,000 assessed value of any real property or personal property in the form of mobile home used exclusively for residential purposes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
And what year was that?
That would have been, I'm saying, 82. It was when they implemented the reappraisal, so early 80s.
And I'll roll back to it.
And that was statute, right? Yeah.
2% a year. Right. For the last couple of years.
So there's some
compound.
Yeah, I don't know about compound. That's a big number.
Yeah, but it is. What it hurt us was when the economy fell.
Sure.
The prices of homes came down.
But you can only come back 2%.
Exactly.
You can fall 15,
you can fall 60.
Right, but you can only come back 2 years.
Right.
Yeah, and you're never going to catch up. Never going to catch up. But that's like I said, the our area, it affects us more than it does the other areas. And that's obviously the battle you guys have, because you have to help other areas that it doesn't affect as much into doing something that really affects us here in the Panhandle. A good example is this airport we're in. If you go 15 minutes south and 20 minutes north of here, there's corporate jets at those hangers up here, but we don't have them here. The reason we don't is because of the taxes. The taxes is set at the salvage rate, but a salvage rate for a jet sometimes is more than the jets even worth, just because of how valuable the engines are. So the salvage rate really doesn't help get a good corporate jet to locate here. And we've got several businesses that have corporate jets and don't keep.
An updated cost on that homestead would be $35,000, the first $35,000. You'd use 2% a year from 1982, and you'd be a $35,000 a
for the first $35,000.
Sales tax?
I think it's 4.3 local tax and 2% state.
I think a lot of them have meals tax as well.
Yeah, and that's probably what it was. But transportation makes it hard for us to.
Sure.
It makes it hard for us to compete with Frederick County and stuff like that when they have that local ability.
One of the things I think may be helpful, and Jonathan mentioned requesting personal property numbers from county assessors, it may be worth our while to get an estimate from Mark Nico, the Department of Revenue, for what a 1% sales tax would do for each county, because if that's the direction we want to go in, and you factor in Eddie's idea of giving back the severance, and that way we can have some kind of idea whether it's an avenue we want to pursue or not. Once we figure out what these southern counties who are extremely concerned about not having the personal property revenue, they know that the declining population, they know that their sales tax isn't going to make up that revenue, but we need to know what that number is and then figure out the calculation based on what they would get from the severance tax. So I think it's important if we had some kind of estimate to go along with those personal property numbers to also have consumer sales tax at 1%.
The problem is, we were told 3 years ago that the state tax department don't break down the tax bill that way. Walmart's a good business in West Virginia, and Walmart's in West Virginia.
That's exactly right. Right. That's what we were told. So, and then there's the GPS issue, too. Because
right.
I think right now it's all zip code.
Matthew has actually been working with the state tax department. He's gotten a pretty good number for us. It's about $11 million.
Yeah.
1% is $11 million. 1 cent would be $11 million for us.
So they can figure that out for Berkeley County. They can come up with a number for the other 54.
It doesn't include one.
Does that include the municipality too? That's the whole county.
It's upward. It's above the line.
Alan, what did you say the personal property number was?
No, it's a sales.
No, but
personal property about $6 million.
So the personal property is $6 million, and the 1% sales tax is $11 million.
Correct. And the best part about it is, the folks paying the $6 or $7 million are all Berkeley County residents. The folks paying the $11 million are anybody that stops in here and purchases something subject to consumer sales tax.
Sure.
So this is not all a tax paid by residents of Berkeley County.
80-some thousand people a day.
Right.
It also taps in on them.
Hey, Al, that $6 million is the county council part.
That's our portion. That is not,
it's not
the whole building. The Board of Education.
Okay.
That's just
because education gets 82%.
I think.
Yes, that's just what we get.
Okay, gotcha.
Well, they get 82% with the levies and the bonds. I think, without a doubt, once the sales tax will take care of it,
it'll take care of the county commission, but it's not the school.
That's the big one.
I think you can make us all just by people like us, told by just amongst ourselves.
Right. It's keeping the school board.
And what do you get from severance a year?
Sorry?
What do you get from the coal severance a year?
We set coal severance last year at 300,000. Everton didn't make it. We're at 180 this year. We
shouldn't need it this year.
So
we're very conservative on number two.
I can't put a dollar.
20 to 50%?
It's probably 10-15%. But when you're out there for hours. It's not like you go take care of a problem.
But
you're out there for hours.
That 10 or 15% of the time out there, it doesn't count for all the traffic being going on the 11.
Totally.
It doesn't count for anything that's happening off of 81 that calls by.
Before, John, before you start sharpening your pencil too quick, I saw you like the numbers. This can't be a wash. This one-cent sales tax can't be a wash. It has to. It has to be a benefit to us so that we can hire the necessary people.
But he's saying you're giving up 6 to get 11.
Okay, I might have missed that from the second part.
Right, he said from the personal property tax, you're giving up 6 to get 11.
Yeah.
But that's only for the county commission. You still have the 82% of it that you don't have for the school board.
Right.
It's a very complex problem. I mean, I just
want to make sure.
Here's the thing, too.
Especially for a contract. I'm good at reading the tape, but man, it's complex, man.
Here's the one thing that we're facing, that you guys here to talk about, and Eddie knew about one thing, is that we're being faced, we currently have two fire companies out of five. We have one that's already got 24/7/365. We currently have two fire companies, Back Creek Valley and South Creek, that have given us written notice that they need the 24/7/365 fire company. Two paid firefighters, 24/7/365. The other two, the manager said that they'd be a fool not to accept it. And they would like to have it, but they got, in my opinion, a very proud people. That alone will eat up the remainder of that $11 million. By far.
You don't generate enough revenue from the fire fee to pay for the
fire fees collection will over $2 million, and that is just to keep the fire hall, the lights on the fire hall, paying the fire hall, and the apparatus. And the firefighters will tell you that they need more money because even
that's not even $500,000 a year for the fire hall. That's not much money. Especially when you look at what equipment costs.
We talked in previous years, maybe the last year, the year before, you guys were talking to us about tweaking the fire fee statute and what you're allowed to use the money for. Did we get that from you?
Yeah, basically.
I thought
we made it to where we used to have to get an official sign of 10% of registered voters. Right? Which would have been 8,000 signatures.
To be able to change the fire.
To be able to change the fire fee.
Okay. Well, I remember that.
Now we got a referendum.
Wasn't there another piece of that had to do with what you were allowed to use the money for? Because you guys, this is coming back to me now, you guys are having to go to your general revenue to get the payroll for the guys that you we're paying in those departments.
Right, but what I'm trying to lead into, and I can't make this commitment because of the big price number, but if we was that able to have a 1 cent sales tax, we, the county council, have already put over $2 million in paying for these firefighters that was never intended the way we were structured to pay for any fire. Paying over $2 million a year now, probably about 2.2 million.
Yeah, we have 22 career firefighters.
Right, 22. We have 22 on staff firefighters just to do what we're doing 5 days a week, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. But yes, but what I'm getting at, Charlie, is Eddie and seeing John use his pencil over there. If you have $11 million that we could gain from the 1 cent sales tax, we turn back down and use $6 million on personal property tax. That gives us $5 million left over to put towards a cause like that. But I will tell you that we do that. You know, if the fee was increased to cover what the firemen were saying, you got to think these people don't understand what our volunteer firemen in the state of West Virginia. I know you don't understand. 100% volunteer. You'll get nothing. And it's like a second job.
And there's a mechanism to raise that fire. You know, we put it in for a public referendum. If people want to have services, they'll have to move for the services.
And that's a 3-year process.
Yeah.
And Matt, we're starting that process.
Right.
But the first thing you got to do is get the buy-in from the volunteers, and someone knows how hard that is.
I know those guys. Right. Right.
And then you got to do it jointly. And then you got to go through the referendum on the ballot, plus you got to have about a 9 month minimum to educate the public on why you need it. And then you turn back around, you got to hit the timing right, because the billing cycle for the fire board's got to be a certain time. That's why time was of essence the last time. So I'm just letting you know where that additional money could be spent.
That's another place. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I think Jason said, you know, if you were using a sales tax base rather than putting more burden on the citizens in the county by raising your fire fees, you would be, you know, the visitors to your county would be helping to subsidize those services when really they're using I-81, where a lot of those calls are from out of state people.
Right.
So it's just using the sales tax or consumption based tax rather than putting more fees on your.
You're generating that revenue from people that are passing through.
The education process is really important with us putting that on the ballot. The reason is a lot of our population come from Virginia and Maryland and relocate here and don't even know that we have volunteer firefighters that they're relying on. You know?
What's the same with the ambulance fee? I mean, I was doing some work up to the station up in Inwood for the ambulance authority. And the gentleman stopped in there and said, hey, is there anybody here I can talk to? And I said, no, just contractors are here. He said, well, we had to use the ambulance service, and I got a bill. He said, I pay ambulance fee. And I said, well, sir, you have to take it up with the county. I said, but you know, your ambulance fee is not going to cover your ambulance service. I mean, it's
right.
A portion of. And you have to educate people.
You
right.
Told him to call Jim.
I did. Yeah. So I said, call Jim Barber, and here's his personal cell. And actually, here's his wife's number. Let me
good thing he's not here.
Thank y'all for that. But I can tell you the need is here. And if we're able to do stuff, you know, they wouldn't be so dependent upon fees. Right? But we got to be careful about the taxes, because the straight math is if the tax we get 18%, if the fee we get 100%. The taxes would have to go up 6 times for us to get the same amount of money. Mental hygiene, I think you all made progress on that.
We have more to do.
Yeah. That's a serious problem for us. I mean, if we can, it's another place where we can save. What are we spending that? Is that going to count $960, but that's not. Mental hygiene.
Can we do the virtual mental hygiene hearings now? Can we pass that?
That guy over there said he'd help you.
No, and that's one of those things that in today's world, with all this Zoom that's been going on for the last couple of years, and we're still not able to...
I'm sorry, I thought we passed court cases.
So, there was a bill passed last year that allows for telehealth.
Yes.
And there was some debate during session as to whether that included the mental hygiene process. And apparently it does. The Supreme Court then has to implement a system by which they can have these mental hygiene evaluations done virtually. So in September and October interns, there was a presentation given, an update of the study resolution, and it was said that the Supreme Court was working on implementing that ability to have them done virtually when feasible.
So the short answer is we're getting there.
It has not been done yet, though. And we budget about $50,000 just for fuel costs.
For shares just
and
to run back.
Evaluation. The problem is, anytime you do a mental hygiene transport, it takes two people. And up until recently, we were pulling two deputies off the road. We have 60 uniformed deputies that cover 24/7, and you may even want to talk about the state police in a little
and
bit.
And do they take them all the way to Butler County, or where do they take them?
Sharp.
A lot of times you're over there and they say, no, you don't have anybody. You get back and they say, okay, you come back.
It's not unusual for us to have four people on the road during any shift.
They pass each other.
So we did work out an agreement where we're now paying overtime to some of our court security officers to ride with the deputy. And that does a couple things. It keeps our court security officers are paid a little bit less than deputies, so it saves us a little bit of budget, but it keeps more deputies on the road.
But some of you think we're moving in the right direction.
I don't believe that any further legislation is necessary.
Okay.
I don't think the Supreme Court simply needs to implement
and promulgate how that's going to work.
Will WVU East, what used to be City Hospital, take an involuntary commitment?
No.
You know, that might be worth exploring.
Yeah, they won't do it.
Because and that would help, you know, not just Berkeley County, but all the counties in the East. And that's, you know, they made a big investment in that facility, and I do think they have a psychiatric ward.
Well, at one point, we asked them just to do a temporary 48-hour hold for us. They wouldn't even do that.
Well, that could. I'm willing to help facilitate some conversations with the university brass, perhaps, to see if that question could be revisited. Because I think the facility in Jefferson County is also a West Virginia University facility. I don't know. I will say this publicly on the record. You know, almost any time when we've asked Gordon Gee put a shoulder to the wheel and help tackle a big problem in this state, he has been willing to do it. He's done it. So, you know, the worst that could happen is it doesn't work out. Maybe we ought to open those kinds of discussions. Yeah. That would get those guys off the road doing the sharp and baby.
We've even had a conversation about me and Jason have talked about having a virtual magistrate. Right? So some of these, you could have a two or three virtual magistrates. You could have a magistrate sitting in Harrison County that could do a be on call, and could do an arraignment in Berkeley County at 2 in the morning or 10 at night when it's hard to get a magistrate in to come in, and that could save you a jail cost.
Right.
You know?
That makes huge sense when you start talking about the thing you've been working about
the redistribution of magistrates.
On top side of the magistrate load.
Right, we could say, listen, we're gonna have three virtual magistrates. They could work in any county as long as they had a broadband connection.
Right. I think there's got to be just a little bit in history. You got to be sure that they are invested in the county interest.
Sure.
Because if not, then they won't care about saving.
Right, because they're not running for election in that county.
No, right. They won't. They just won't. You know, it's not any problem years ago. Have one individual that was not invested, she wasn't invested in Berkeley County, it didn't matter. So, but mental hygiene, I guess it's the same thing as time is invested, the sooner you get something in place, the better it's going to be.
Right.
It's not so much the $50,000 that we spend in fuel a year, but it's also the two vehicles that
at City Hospital has a different feeling about dealing with non-violent offenders versus violent people. And they're very reluctant to deal with violent folks because they don't have the staff or really the facilities to deal with them. And those are the people you really want to move out sometimes.
It is sad that we aren't given more attention to mental hygiene patients in the state of West Virginia, but that seems to be one of the things a lot of experience. Unhealthy people are not on the medication, they're homeless, they're, you know, it seems like, you know, we could do a better job sometimes, especially this time of year. Anything else on mental hygiene? Some effects will bring us up to speed on that. Just again, we understand things take time and money, but time is money. Home confinement also, that one gained a lot of traction some of last year.
It passed both chambers, but then died in the last night of session because of some things that were added to it. But
I think this year
should be a real easy fix.
I think so, and I've introduced this bill for a number of years, and we got almost all the way there. And as you said, it kind of died last night. There were some technical errors put in the bill last minute we didn't catch, and just ran out of time on the 60th day. It is my understanding from the Sheriff's Association that there were two conflicting bills last year dealing with home confinement officers and their ability to carry firearms, and so I think we're going to have to go back and clean it up anyway. So while that's a bad thing to have those code conflicts, it'd probably give us a really good reason to go in and fix that this year, and I'm optimistic.
Under the code, it has a broad category definition of law enforcement officers, and that enables them to carry a weapon. And it includes park police, police officers, motor carrier inspectors, way enforcement inspectors, county litter control officers. It has a whole laundry list of folks, but it never ever mentions home confinement officers. So all we want is under that definition, which is section 30-29-16, under the definition of law enforcement officer, just add home confinement officers. It names everybody else, but for whatever reason, home confinement officers.
It was just a technical error, right? It wasn't like no one put a poison pill in it.
No.
That wasn't in the bill. He's saying that that's the fix.
But to your question, no, both houses passed.
Yeah, because I think I remember us talking about it was on the last night.
It was, yeah. So
it's crazy.
I should know better than to say this, but I think that's a pretty easy lift issue. We should be able to fix that. Again, I should know better than
to say that. I see what I'm
saying. All right. This one here is something I'm not so sure if we have the power to do it internally, but hotel, motel, we all made progress on the campgrounds and Airbnb and stuff last year, but hotel, motel tax, that's all done by, you know, trust.
Trust.
So there's no audits of ever those.
So does that get sent to like the auditor and that goes into OASIS or anything like that? It should go just to the tax office the same way consumer sales tax does. So I'm not sure that, and I understand your point, I'm not sure that the state tax office has the manpower to be able to audit those. I mean, if you start to go auditing all of the hotel motel, then we're going to ask the state tax office to audit every business's consumer sales tax form every month.
Give us an opportunity.
Well, and if that's what you're asking for, then that's a different story. But
yeah.
I don't know if that's a consumer sales tax paid to, I guess it's paid directly to the state tax office, and then the tax office then distributes it back to the county, correct?
You all do all the state sales tax. I can tell you that.
Yes, but not. We don't audit every one of them every month.
No, but it's very difficult to get your 6% sales tax back. I can tell you that.
I don't think there's no mechanism at all where the state does any audit on hotel motel tax. I think it's an on your honor type system. They put in you know, it's kind of like the B&O tax inside the city. I mean, inside the city, if you turn in what you need to pay.
Well, and consumer sales tax in the state is largely the same way.
Right.
So, I guess all we're asking for maybe something in legislation that gives us a clear authority to be able to do actually. If we don't do it now in the attorney's office, we've hired people to start a going act. Unfortunately, we find another place to go to. But if we was able to hire an IT, that would be part of their job in the IT department, is to audit hotel motel tax. We don't want someone to say, well, you don't have the authority to do that.
So you're talking about like an annual audit?
Talking about is being able to say, okay, this year we're going to audit these hotels, and next year we're going to audit these hotels, or whatever, or be able to look at it and say, you know what, we know that a hotel occupancy is almost 100%, and we look at the numbers, and we're only getting 50% hotel motel.
So with the ability to audit the hotel, more likely that you're going to get accurate.
Exactly. Yeah.
And what brought this to our attention is during the build out of Procter & Gamble, every hotel and every campground in the county was filled. But then when we looked at the hotel motel tax and compared it to previous years, there wasn't any big jump. Well, something's wrong with the reporting mechanism.
They were moved directly to the county. And I guess if they're inside the city to the municipal government, or do they remit to the Travel Bureau? How does that work?
They pay directly to the treasurer.
Like a hotel, if I'm a hotel and I'm not in the city,
yes. Comes to us.
But from where?
From the state tax office.
Yeah, it's a bit right off the
state. It comes from the state tax office?
Yeah.
No, sir. It's paid directly to the sheriff, Alan.
No, it's paid directly. I'm sorry. It's paid directly to the sheriff.
So yes. If they're paying you directly, you should.
You're paying the state tax office, and then it's going to the sheriff.
It's being paid directly to the sheriff.
From who?
From the hotel motel.
Oh, well, then the ability to audit may be a lot easier.
You should have the ability to audit.
The statement is correct, but we don't have any teeth.
Yeah, I think
but
the county and the city
should again and make
it yes.
Without yeah, the state. If it's not going to the state.
And then when they pay it to you guys and you divide it up, a Travel Bureau gets a piece of it. Yeah. You guys parse it out.
CDB gets 50%. We got 50% discretion with the department recommends that.
But you're the ones that split it out.
So you're saying that the department would be more rewarded for the ordinance of ours?
I don't know that.
Did you just call village office?
Doug, I can check. There's a recent change, too, that's going to make it easier. That made, because hotel motel tax is a local tax. It's created locally, it's administered locally, and it's enforced locally. Now, what changed 2 years ago is that the state decided that they were going to charge a sales tax for hotel motel occupancy also. So now, if you rent a room, you owe the local hotel motel tax, and you owe a sales tax to the state of West Virginia.
We could cross-reference.
Well, you could get a cross-reference, or just the fact that now exists, that the power of the state of West Virginia will come down on the hotel operator who doesn't pay their hotel motel sales tax. I think just generally enforcement is going to improve, because you're right, the enforcement mechanism of hotel motel taxes are always been a complicated, convoluted local administration right. process. But two things, actually after that change, was Airbnb is now required to collect that, and they're going to put it on their platform. The state is going to try to help platforms administer that tax and turn it over to the local authorities as required. But all those regulatory processes, I think, are going to improve local compliance even without an audit, because it's always been difficult for the sheriff to go to Motel 6 and find out, well, how many rooms did you rent last night, and did you turn in your money, and I need to see your books, and those kind of things. So it's always been complicated. But I think just without the ability to do this, generally compliance with your local hotel motel tax is going to increase. Just because the other enforcement and mechanism.
So can we do a quick cross-reference on that, Gary, then? On the sales tax versus the retail motel tax on hotels?
The problem is the answer of how many rooms are there? That's all we care to know, right? So if you have 5,000 rooms available in the county, right? How many rooms were filled? We can do the math on the rest, but they're not obligated. They won't tell us. We casually just reach and got instant, no thank you. So.
Yeah, but if they're taking sales tax off of each of those rooms, mm-hmm. we should be able to do a cross reference off of sales tax and
where we should be.
Hotel tax to determine whether or not we're getting the same amount of rooms.
Good.
But if you remember, a couple years ago, we hired Brad Race, and that was going to be one of his primary responsibilities. The hotels wouldn't let him in the door to see the books because they didn't feel they had any obligation, obligation to tell us.
Well, the state of West Virginia might have that information now for sales tax that you could cross-reference with the state of West Virginia.
Yeah, but is the state of West Virginia going to give the county the sales tax data for private business?
Well, I don't, and still sales tax data is self-administered by whoever the business is. So, but yeah, they may
see all of us both.
So I've only seen that as a difficulty to be able to get that type of information from the state anytime in the past. So I don't know that that's going to be accessible.
Yeah, I don't know if they're going to give the tax from a private taxpayer to give that information to a local government entity.
I don't know if this is helpful, but I think on the 13th, there's going to be a webinar. We sent out something on our listserv about it, and I think it's with the Hospitality Association, where they're going to do an educational webinar on tax collection for the online platforms. I think it's because there was some sort of tax legislation that's effective January 1, I think. So that might be somewhat helpful to look at to see how we're going to be doing that collection. And then they'll be responsible for reporting that information. And I can resend it.
That's the other thing they're saying. They're not letting us in the room. How do we say we have the right to shut you down if you don't want to cooperate?
I think any governmental entity that receives a tax should have the ability to audit. We have to tweak statute. That seems reasonable.
So in that terms, me as the owner of Stevens Painting and general contractor could be audited by the city of Martinsburg for being a local.
So I know the city of Martinsburg does. Mm-hmm. They do audits. You know,
they send you out a bill. But you're right. They can audit. But it's on your own, your honor. I mean, you just basically pay what you say you pay.
Yeah, I do that every month.
Right.
Okay.
But they have the ability to audit it.
Yeah, I'm going to be another. Same thing about sales tax.
Well, I've heard that there's still a lot of 1 cent sales tax getting paid for outside of city.
Yes, there is.
And why haven't we figured out how to solve that problem?
All right. We didn't. The next one is rail betrayal. Matt, do you want to talk on this one? You'll have to come up and speak loud.
Okay.
Yeah, that'll be a problem.
I passed out a handout here with the United States on the front. It's just kind of an overview. It goes into a little background there initially, but essentially what we have in West Virginia is that there are no rails with trails in West Virginia. The only one that exists anywhere near West Virginia is the bridge that crosses the Pacific River at Harpers Ferry. If you've all been out there, you've crossed that pedestrian bridge that connects the two national parks. So essentially it touches West Virginia, but it was all done under the umbrella of the national park system. We all know it's a Dillon state. If you
know what that means. I know some of the attorneys in the room do. If it's not expressly stated that you can do it in code, we don't know whether you can do it. This packet contains some information about some challenges with rails with trails in West Virginia and why some of the Class 1 railroads, the CSX, the Norfolk Southern, the big, large railroad companies are not really big fans of rails with trails. However, the smaller railroads, short line railroads like Winchester Western, basically the low mileage, low miles per hour railroads. For example, Winchester Western is only allowed to go 10 miles an hour on its track through Berkeley County. That's the fastest it's allowed to go on the track. So it's relatively low as far as danger, risk, and all that, the liability, which gets into that issue where Senator Maynard introduced a liability bill for railroads for the rails to trails last session, which is also in this handout. So I took a look at the code, the existing code for rails to trails, and you can pull it up and look at it. There's some outdated definitions in there from the very beginning of the code section. That's addressed in here. It also, this handout also incorporates Senator Maynard's proposal for liability, to address liability issues. And there's an email in here. I don't know how big it is in font, but it's from the Rails and Trails Council. It outlines some of their challenges they've faced over the years. Berkeley County has one of the charges I have in my role is the, I always butcher my own title, isn't that terrible? The Director of Policy and Strategic Planning and Communications is quality of life projects. And one of the things that the commission, council members have asked me to do is explore trail opportunities. You wouldn't think it, but we actually have had a number of rail infrastructure over the years here in Berkeley County. Some of them are abandoned rail spurs to quarries. Others are obviously like Winchester Western. And the project we've been talking about did a lot of work on was trying to connect the canal, the CNO canal, across the river to Berkeley County on the north end at Sportsman's Paradise. Obviously, if there's a partnership there that we can work with Winchester and Western to do essentially a similar bridge that the Harpers Ferry Bridge has there, it would be truly awesome to have that, obviously, as a quality of life improvement. But there's liability concerns, and that issue with Senator Maynard that he introduced last year, it ended up getting bundled into another bill and then it died. But anyway, I think it would be a catalyst not just for Berkeley County to help rails with trails. And if you read this packet, you'll see that states across the country have seen an increase of rails with trails all across the country. It's not something new, it's been out there for a long time. The U.S. Railroad Administration and the Federal Highway Administration produced a study that came out in the middle of the, probably got buried by COVID really last year, that basically did a very in-depth study analysis of what we've learned, lessons from rails with trails, looked at the growth of them across the country, and West Virginia just simply isn't in the mix. We all know about quality of life. Berkeley County is in competition for, you know, just like every other community in our region, for you know, best places to live. And I think there's a real desire to make Berkeley County a great place to live and keep it competitive with neighboring jurisdictions. You guys touched on about getting the upper executives, keeping them living here and residing here in Berkeley County. And in order to do that, you have to have amenities like trails. And we've done calculations on how many miles of trail we have per square mile in this county. And we don't rank as high as we need to be in that area. We need more trails, there's no question about that. But we need this legislation, I think, to make it very clear, and I outlined a proposal in here on how to possibly at least make it very clear, black and white, that rails with trails are permitted in West Virginia, and not only permitted, but address the liability concern that basically eases the apprehension of a short line railroad like Winchester and Western from, you know, objecting to a partnership. That's essentially what this is about here. If you review this, if you have any questions, I'll entertain any questions.
We're now going to study down the Fortune Paradise, which we own about 70 acres now?
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
Yes.
So one of the things that Matt set up for us was a meeting with the superintendent of Seminole Canal at the Race Board to discuss about the connection of Fortune Paradise to the canal. And then we talked, we was at a meeting with Winchester Western, and the easiest way, the Seminole Canal superintendent said, the easiest way to get over to the canal would be to do a pedestrian addition to Winchester Western. Once we talked to them, and we said something to them, and they said, no. I presume it's because of liability. But that, by far, you can see a cantilever, the pedestrian bridge on the side, possibly, and be able to get over there and make it pretty simple. But that's one of the reasons why we're finding rails with trails is important. And then after rails to trails, we're working pretty aggressively on that right now.
And if I could just interject just a little slight piece of information. There are even small areas throughout the Winchester Western Corridor where not only could we lay broadband down alongside that railroad maybe, but bring about a trail as well at the same time. But also there's even if you did a small connector, especially around Spring Mills High School or Musselman High School, believe it or not, there's all these schools, or you've heard of the Safe Routes to School program maybe, where they've addressed school access via pedestrian. And there's amazingly how many connections between parks and schools all along Winchester Western Corridor where a small little trail connection along the railroad would actually improve the pedestrian connection to the school. So there's opportunity, or the park, because there's actually parks and schools all along that corridor where this trail system or a rails with trails project could be developed.
Would this impact any private landowners?
Well, the Rails with Trails essentially is a partnership between the railroad and the public recreation.
So it would not necessarily impact.
It would obviously require some, you know, if there was some need for acquisition of right of way with a private party. Yes, yes. I mean, you would.
They were talking about putting a trail along the Tuscarora Pike, and that was the big objection was the landowners.
Tuscarora Creek? Are you talking about the Tuscarora Creek or the Pike?
The Creek. I'm sorry.
Creek.
There was not the Pike, the Creek.
Right.
And there was objection from the private landowners.
Correct. I recall that very clearly from 2006 and 2007.
So
right.
That's
correct.
Why I'm asking that question.
Right. Right. Yeah, I mean, you're obviously going to have some interface with private parties along the other side, opposite to the railroad side of the trail. But, you know, obviously this is a quality of life improvement. Not only is it a quality of life improvement, but if you're actually improving safety from the people who are illicitly walking the railroad, an active railroad, and getting hit by trains and such. And you're also adding value to all those property owners along that corridor. And giving them an amenity at the same time. Now, you also see that as a NIMBY. I know where you're going with the NIMBY, not my backyard perspective. And I agree there is that concern. But I think if you look at the studies and what's been shown, what's been found, especially if you look at the Mon Trail in Morgantown or some of the other trails around the state, the vast majority of those NIMBY concerns, those not in my backyard concerns, are actually very small.
Matt, any questions for Matt on that? Rails and trails?
Thanks.
We're trying to be very competitive with our neighboring states and counties, but making sure that Berkeley County is making a difference for quality of life. That would help. The other one was West Virginia Outdoor Heritage Conservation Fund.
I'm actually working on a piece of legislation for that right now.
Okay, good.
So in my
I know you, that Matt has about four different options here, but my direction was to go with option two. Well, that's the direction that I would try to go to leave that fund. What about the county's keep? So let the county keep that fund, and that it be used for county use, and the county would, you know, either report to the state or that organization how they spent those funds in a very transparent way. But if we're going to spend the money for the funds and not receive any service for the funds, then we should at least retain them. And that's what my legislation would be. Okay. So now I don't know, you know, Chuck's got a better relationship with the outdoors guy.
Director McDaniel.
Director McDaniel. He didn't like me very much, so maybe we should let Chuck take the lead on
this. Well, I've been working with him on some other issues.
Yeah.
And I wanted to talk to you probably about this Horses Paradise County's plans down there and all. Perhaps we could get DNR to put a boat ramp there down there also.
Yeah, we're talking with them on that.
Oh, okay.
We're talking, we had Max go to that meeting. We met with them on Horses Paradise. We also met with them on the Stone Bridge.
I'll bring it up. I should be speaking to Director McGain tomorrow. I'll bring it up also. Talk to him.
Correct me if I'm wrong. There's not one public ramp in the Potomac River in West Virginia.
You're correct.
Perfect gun. Because I brought that up to McDaniel, and he didn't believe me.
He heard it from me, too.
He heard it from Jason. I said, there's not one public ramp. And then we had a situation where we had a blockage on the effect. That was a small blockage that turned into a huge blockage. And I contacted them to try to get it cleared. And they said, we can't do nothing about that. It's what you call it. I don't know. We can't. I'm like, well, if who the hell do we call? If we don't call you, who the hell do we call?
We just had a committee meeting that discussed that.
They wanted us to get the Department of Highways involved.
It used to be the Soil Conservation Office used to pay to have blockages.
This one was huge. It was all the way across the Apecan, and it was probably 60 yards deep.
There's an entity that deals with that. I don't recall the name, but
we'll let Chuck in.
Conservation.
They like it.
I was in that meeting.
Yeah.
Sure.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
There was actually another one. There was another one upstream from Route 9 in the Apecan.
Well, the Apecan has become a very busy piece of water for recreation. I mean, a lot of kayakers and, you know, floaters. I mean, a lot of people use that piece of that water from, you know, Inwood all the way to the mouth of the coast. It's very busy, and it's, I think we should do our due diligence to keep those waterways open for recreational, for people that buy a fishing license and spend their money in the state to buy kayaks and canoes and stuff. I mean, that's a public access and public water, and I feel the same thing for the Potomac. I mean, I know maybe some private landowners on the Potomac don't want to have a public access to the river, but I think it's everybody's waterway, and there should be a minimum of one public ramp.
Absolutely. You know. Well, DNR offices are talking to us about partnering up with them on the Packet Creek at the Stone Bridge. So they're asking us to partner up with them.
Yeah, that's an absolutely perfect place to do it.
Right.
You know?
Like that. I mean, so. Matt, you may recall the conversation better, but they feel that in a roundabout way, we can do it better, I guess. And they want us to be able to police it and stuff like that.
Well, the parcel's about, if memory serves me right, 12 acres, 14
acres,
7 acres. And they don't need near that much land for the boat ramp. So they wanted to know if we would be willing to work with them so that we could send down community service to empty the trash, and in exchange it would allow us to put some walking trails and things like that.
Well, Mr. Collis down in Bedford, he would always keep the access to the Apecan Creek there by the bridge, and he had a big garbage can down there, and all he ever asked people was to do was to put the garbage in the can, and he would keep it cleaned up. Now, he's since passed away, and the new renters there, they don't keep it access, which is fine, but that's what he did. If you use the garbage can, he would keep it empty, and everyone had access.
Yeah. So we're trying to improve upon that.
Sure.
We're just trying to do what we can do as much as possible. But, you know, it's one of the things that back to it seems like we're constantly giving more
Well, we gotta pull up the slack. I mean, when the state makes it two-thirds short on their staff in Berkeley County, and the governor said, we take the state troopers to the more less fortunate counties. You all have the money to do more. And I have a great relationship with the governor, but so that means that we're gonna have to have somewhere deputies to pick up without any additional revenue. That's what we're saying. And that's what we're saying about the 1 cent sales tax or anything. Eddie said it. We can't be revenue neutral because we're taking on the responsibilities of state. You know, it used to be DEP controlled water. Now we have MS4 stormwater utility company that does it. DEP don't do it anymore.
Do we have, this is probably a question for answer, a question for Alan. Do we have any estimates on the amount that we send into this Heritage Fund every year, the fee?
Matt may have that. Matt, do you have that?
Yes, we have numbers on that. I don't have them right off
the
top.
Could you email that to me?
Yes.
Can you get a chance?
Yes, absolutely.
So I have that from my...
If you take a close look at that section of code, it obviously gives a portion of those funds to the DNR.
That's in the West Virginia Code 5B2G.
Yeah, it's in that attachment.
Charlie's probably got a memorized.
It's in the attachment.
There's a draft bill there. Is that, did you do that, Matt?
Yes, I did.
Okay, I'm going to take it with me and we'll get it to offer.
Yes, I mean, but obviously taking money away from the DNR, I don't think is necessarily our goal, and maybe not even a winnable pursuit. I don't know, but at the very least, this packet of information basically outlines that the current process is unworkable. And Mr. Chabon with the Farmland Protection Board was very intimately familiar, even though he's in Farmland Protection, of how cumbersome the application process currently is. 20 pages for a grant of money. That's our money, essentially. The counties across the state, it's their money, it's just unworkable. And he even described it in his email, which may also be too small to read based on my poor copying abilities here, but he described it as a extremely bad application process that at the very least could be reformed to one or two pages easily.
You got bills on both.
Yes.
I was looking at the rails and trails.
Yes.
You got a bill on the other one.
I think so. I believe I did put something together. But anyway,
it's just like four options.
Right. There's a lot there. It's a little bit complicated with the DNR's involvement, but I think there's an opportunity.
Basically, we have there's a yellow folder there. It's got our priorities, which pretty much are in line with your all's. And again, the biggest, the two main issues for us that we're focusing on right now is obviously the per diem. We really want to make sure that we can get an extension on that cap to keep it frozen, especially if there's going to be discussions about moving forward. And then also the 1%, because again, I know we've talked about it most of the afternoon, it does go back to that local authority, just like Berkeley would like to do 1 cent or 1%, and then I know some counties, they don't want to charge the people that live there, they want to go after the tourist folks that are coming in to ski or ride the Hatfield Trail, anything like that. So primarily that's what we're focused on, and if we can do anything for it, we definitely want to work with you all. We want to have a seat at the table, and we want to be able to talk everything through, make improvements for everybody.
Yes, the one issue, there's three issues. We talked about the jails, talked about property tax reform. The main issue that my members are really after this year is getting pay raise. So we'll be working on that. It's based on consumer price index, cost of living. And the last raise was 8 years ago. The raise before that was 8 years before that. And I think the one before that was 12 years. So we look at this as trying to keep really good jobs, good professionals, attract them to these jobs. They're great jobs, you know. You have great staff at the courthouse and great work. main thing we'll be focused on, certainly those other issues, supporting Jennifer on revenue, sales tax, things like that. Each group has several issues. I'm not going to be working on them as much. I mean, certain clerks have a lot of fees issues, things like that. They do. Prosecutors certainly want to do things on sentencing and criminal justice reform, and I'm not going to embarrass myself in front of the chairman here talking about law enforcement legal issues. The sheriffs, we talked about that, mental hygiene reform. They also want to consolidate their salary into one salary that they're paid a commission to. They want to put the commission to a base salary.
You know that you almost guaranteed the extra $15,000 bonus as a sheriff in Berkeley County, but yet you can't. The lending institution won't look at it and guarantee it.
The county clerks, of course, their thing really is the elections, and you know they're working hard on redistricting right now. There's no bill per se they're going to introduce. There's some bills in the past couple of years having to do with deeds property, and I think the auditor had a bill last year introduced that they support that one. And I'm not going to speak to your commissioners, Jennifer talked about them. I think I've covered them all. Assessors, again, certainly very interested in property tax reform, everything going on with that, and are working very hard on those figures, as well as just to update you last evening in the interims. There was a rules bill for oil and gas valuations. They're changing the tax valuations. And late last evening, about 5:30, they pulled it for a month. I think they're going to take it back up again in the next interim session before the session begins.
Is that the same rule we're
It has to 2581, which will change the valuations and the rules that go into it. There was an amendment offered, and that's why I got sideways a little bit yesterday. So Senator Weld and I were talking about that. He texted me to take a bullet. But we've offered certainly to have assessors as well as our property tax guy, Jerry Knight, to sit down and meet with anybody, you know, to talk about those issues and try to iron something out maybe that we kind of agree to. So that's where that is.
Anything that you all need from us?
I have a question for you guys. This is just a question I asked Alan about this. For our county paid fire staff, they fall under the PERS for their retirement. So that means that they may have a 30 or 35 year career. Is there any way, now I'm not advocating that the county runs the business, your business the way you want to run your business, but is there anything that needs to be done legislatively if you guys wanted to put those county fire aid staff under like the municipal retirement or under like the civil servant retirement, and then the paid county fire staff could retire in 20 years? Like most firefighters.
I was going to say, like, not being like a municipal.
Yeah.
Is that a county decision to put them under PERS for cost, or is there legislation that needs to be passed that would allow you as county councilman to put them under the municipal or the civil service?
I'm not sure the code will allow us right now.
There's no language there. There's no avenue to put these guys into a retirement plan.
And there's discussion now, I'm sure Jonathan's been tracking a little bit. Eric Nelson is the Senate chair of the Pensions Committee, and I serve on that. There's been some discussions of PERS 3 for those public service employees. You know, the deputy sheriffs had their own system. The DNR guys had their own system. But there's some talk of having a different tier system. You've got to have actuaries involved in seeing how much it would cost. It would do what you're talking about, accelerate retirement benefit. People who are in those lines of work for most of the county.
Well, I can only see our county paid staff grow. I mean, it's going to continue to grow.
Absolutely.
And if we can put them in a better situation for retirement, that would be better for retention and recruitment.
I can tell you, John, that if we knew what's needed in Berkeley County right now, Greg Cromer, our fire staff would be the size of our sheriff.
be nice to be able to have the paid professional fireman in the same retirement as the deputy sheriff. Basically the same type of
thing. Well, that may be the route to go.
That's maybe, you know, there's politics involved in some of that, but actuaries first. You know, the other thing we learned in Mary Cackley, was talked to me for years about the job, that job, you know, dispatch now is traumatized. It is, people don't last long, you know. They have shorter careers in those jobs because of how traumatizing it is to do that all day. And so that, I think that's under discussion too.
And I have one other quick question. Our ambulance authority, they are one of the, and this is probably not here, this is going to be a question for you. Our ambulance authority, professional EMS, RMS, they are one of the few, and their retirements are not state taxes.
There is a court case on that, and I forget who brought the case, but I think it was some federal retirees sued the state of West Virginia and federal and U.S. Supreme Court once we gave other tax benefit tax.
Because we have it on our military retirement.
Yeah. And so if you do it for anyone like ambulance authority, you have to do it for all the federal retirees as well, the folks that are in that type of, in that line of work. And that's, so there's a Supreme Court case on, because I introduced a bill to try to do that, and I got a call from the state tax office right away and said, this is Steger versus somebody. Steger was the former tax commissioner, and I forget the case. Charlie knows better than I do.
So that would open up a can of worms. Not only would our state EMS, RMS,
Yeah, it's like any federal employee, theirs would have to be exempt too.
Gotcha. And see, you know, it concerns me a little bit that each one of these agencies in the county have three separate retirement plans. Why not put them in one?
Consolidated.
The management of investments is consolidated. I think there are 13 different plans that the state operates.
So you've got different investment strategies through different 13 different plans. So if you have one plan, and maybe a good plan, where these folks coming in, you're not only attract people, but you'll keep people who are good retirement plan.
Easily said.
Again, but if you don't have that conversation, it will never
happen. We haven't even figured out how to hire enough to come in.
That's true.
Our problem is we just got our FDID number last year.
Right.
So.
But I think Harrison County is right behind you guys. I think Harrison County is going to come on.
We're the first county that has paid firefighters.
Right.
So we have 40 hour paid firefighters, which starting December 1st will become, or January 1st will become 42 hour paid firefighters. But we also have 56 hour paid firefighters. So we're constantly working on pay issues, and they'll say, well, West Virginia code says, and Anthony's still here, we just met with the folks for the past 2 weeks, West Virginia code says this. Well, no, it doesn't say that. It says municipal paid firefighters. It doesn't apply to us. So we're, every week, something new seems to come up that we have to go back
so
and
new
say.
When you're the first one.
Yeah, does it, you know, we're not a municipality, so a lot of times we have to go back to the federal government and we have to look at what the Fair Labor Standards Act says, particularly with hours of work and compensation and things like that. So it's confusing.
I don't think so.
I have a question. Jonathan brought it up, was the pay raise for county councilmen or county commissioners and elected county officials. Do you all have either a collective opinion or an individual opinion on that?
I can tell you my opinion. My opinion is that your job.
Well, I understand it's my job, but it's all my job, but I want your opinion.
Right. my opinion is that if you guys decide that you think it's the right thing to do, then I'm okay with it, and I'll spend the money. But I'm not going to advocate for a raise. I didn't take the job for the money. I took the job to help out the county.
Sure.
And so I look at the people that work for the county and make sure that they have what they need to sustain their families and do what they need to do. That's how I feel.
I feel the same way about his granddaughter, but at the same time, to give you some idea, I think one of you said earlier, in order to recruit and attract people, it's like your own plan. We're not in it for the play, right?
Of course.
But at the same time, our employees in the 8 years have gained about 40% increase in pay to be competitive, right?
And I wasn't talking specifically about members of the commission or council. I mean, you're also, even though you work for 4 years a week, you still part time job. But the other elected county officials, a lot of those are full time jobs. So I didn't know if you had an opinion on that as well.
I won't stand in your way.
Okay.
I don't know how you feel.
Well, to be honest with you, I've looked at your job before.
You guys were sitting together
before I made the decision. I'm thinking, to disrupt yourself that much? Can I be honest with you? But at the same time, time moves forward and everything becomes a part of it. Quite honestly, I don't need to pay you. Probably other people.
The thing that I said last time is, I took the job for the set salary that I get. That was high. Someone wants to give me a pay raise, I'll take it.
Fair enough.
And I don't know how you feel.
I didn't take it for the money. I did it to try to help out as many people.
Of course.
Yeah.
So I think what everybody's saying is, we got plenty of money.
We just do it for the fun.
Can you just be honest with you, Jason? No, I think if, in my opinion, if legislature was looking at it as county elected officials, I think that it should include all the legislators as well. It shouldn't be just something that's going down for county officials. It should be at all elected officials.
I don't see how you guys do it.
Well, I didn't say it earlier, but I do want to say it. Senator Trump, the last couple of years now, has been the main sponsor for us in the Senate. We got it through the Senate, so I do want to thank you for that. I mean,
thank you. No, you guys, I will say this. You guys did a great job. And I'm not just saying that to blow smoke at you because it's Christmas or anything, but, I think it's true in our panhandle as a whole. You guys have to deal with things that a lot of county government, they all have some of the same challenges. But you guys have special circumstances up here. And I watch and learn. And I appreciate the dedication that all of you have under really tough circumstances with growth and what goes on in this panhandle. And, I think it's reasonable to say the legislature should aspire to the same level of success and commitment that you guys show here in Berkeley County. And we do. We do.
And Charlie, I got to give you all the credit for where I'm at. 2000, we would want to convince me it's very important just to apply. Happened to the ring.
I appreciate the communication. I feel like I have a personal relationship with all you guys. I have all your cell phone numbers. I can pick my phone up and give you a call, pick your brain about something or answer your question. And you guys will always answer and call me right back. And I appreciate that. I think that's really important.
This year, our regular session was so strange because of COVID. And we didn't have people in the building. And the other thing we have, which is gone now, is they were working on the dome. To work on the dome, they walled off the Senate and the West End from the East End of the building. And so it really limited the interaction between delegates and senators. And that, believe it or not, creates its own problems. We were just talking about So that's gone now, and we're hoping that during the session this year, we're not going to be, again, where people are afraid to come to the Capitol and don't want to. There is a little bit of a petri dish aspect to the state Capitol when it's full people, but on behalf of all of us, if you can, come. Come see us while we're down there. It means a lot to us. We get homesick, and it helps us. Makes us better. We're hearing from you what you like, don't like about what we're working on.
So, I guess, yes.
I have heard one complaint, mostly from school teachers, about the number of children who go to school in Berkeley County, particularly children with special needs. These parents drop them off, and they all have Maryland tags on their cars. Now, a lot of these folks will say, oh, they're government cars or they're work cars. But there seems to be an issue with, because we are fairly generous with how we deal with our special needs children, that we might want to look into.
Well, we have been addressing that, but it takes that. If we want to control that, is the assessor and the sheriff. And they have to come to some resolution of being able to, the assessor has to be able to really do it, and the state and the sheriff's department is willing to enforce it. Sheriff now will do that. And then we cross-reference, we have the ability to cross-reference with the assessor's office, the tax office, the school board, and all that stuff. We're working on that. And Gary can back me up, is that correct?
That is correct.
So the last thing and the most important thing is we every year we ask you all to come here and we continue to ask you for more and more stuff. But we also want to say thank you for everything that you did, right? Each and every one of you. I feel that we had a successful year last year. We've gotten things done over the last couple of years. And I just want to say thank you for your sacrifice and what you give up and for the community that you serve and for what you do for us. I absolutely don't want you to unrecognize. We look to enhance our relationship with each and every one of you. And as you know, West Virginia is one of the best places to visit in the whole world right now. So the secret's out. We got to take advantage of it.
And a lot of you visit the state.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Figured it out.
Yeah. So thank you. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas,
Dawn. Can I throw something out there real quick, too? Yeah. Our legislative meeting is January 17th and 18th, and it's at NBC Suites. We will be hosting a legislative reception the night of the 17th, is that right, Denise? At NBC, I think it'll start at 6 p.m., and we just want to encourage anybody and everybody to attend.
And ours is February 6th through the 9th. We'll change our format a little bit this year. And actually, on Tuesday the 8th, we're going to do a day at the Capitol for anybody who wants to be there. We're trying to, Chris and I are trying to structure that for everybody so they're there, going to committee hearings and seeing you and all that stuff. So
that's nice, but sometimes it's hard to get out of the Capitol. Sometimes it's just hard to get out of town.
I'd like to add something, too. If you guys get in session and have an issue that you're arguing and seem to be hitting a wall and need another thought process, don't hesitate to pick up the phone and give us a call, because we'll be glad to bounce it off each other and see what we can come up to give you more tools to be able to argue the point and help us.
The challenges are definitely different here in Eastern Panhandle.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. President, can you recess?
Recess,
please.
Yes.
Since
gentlemen, I have a motion to recess.
I move.